room here are very familiar with MIH, and you know that our mission is to advance the health of all people through biomedical research. And in pursuing that mission, there are certain principles that we hold very dear: scientific rigor, reproducibility, integrity, and also the broad sharing of research data and materials. We wouldn't be here in this room together today if we all did not recognize and have hope about the promise of regenerative medicine. It's one of the most exciting fields in biomedical research today because it aims to not simply treat symptoms, but to actually replace or restore cells and tissues damaged by injury, disease, or aging. NIH is funding several promising avenues of this research, and there are exciting findings in the labs right now that are moving toward clinical application. I wanted to share with you one example from the field of cardiology, where scientists are driving heart muscle cells from induced pluripotent stem cells. And you may have seen some of the spectacular images of this work. One is shown here. Hopefully some of you can see heart cells feeding in unison in a petri dish. These cells are already proving to be exceptionally useful in vitro as lab-based screening tools to test drugs for their efficacy and also their potential cardiotoxic effects. But the hope is that we can use these cells in the clinic to treat hearts damaged by heart attacks or congestive heart failure. But things are not always as simple or straightforward as we would hope. And scientists working with these cells learned that these cell preparations actually can contain a multitude of cells. Cells with very distinct functions, destined to carry out specific roles in different chambers of the heart. And so they set out to better characterize these cell preparations and to manufacture them more reproducibly. But their findings underscore the fact that we heard about in the first session this morning. We have much work to do to really understand the function and identity of the cells that we would intend to put in our patients. And it's our obligation to rigorously test those cell products through preclinical work and clinical trials. And it's this in-depth cell characterization that really underpins this R&D pathway toward treatment. And in thinking about cell characterization, we can think about the full circle, the totality of what we could know about cells that's shown here in the gray circle. Our technology and our methods were perfect today. There are subsets shown in the dark blue circle that are fundamental characteristics that are routinely used to qualify cells in the clinic. And these are basic characteristics like, are the cells alive? Are they sterile? Are they pure? But there's a set of characteristics beyond those, shown in red here, that represents and offers a much deeper portrait of the functioning characteristics of these cells. And this is what we call in-depth fingerprinting or in-depth cell characterization. And by collecting that data and coupling it with data from each patient in every trial so that the experience of every patient counts toward moving things forward, making things better for the next patient, we have an opportunity to learn what characteristics in these cells are important for clinical function and for safeguarding safety. This is not only the view of NIH, it's a roundly agreed upon concept by national and international bodies, including the National Academies, FDA, the International Society for Stem Cell Research, that while regenerative medicine cell therapies offer tremendous promise, we still have much work to do to really understand these cells and to manufacture them reliably in order to provide safe and effective treatments in the clinic. I will not belabor this slide, but just from an NIH perspective, upholding and earning public trust is absolutely critical to this endeavor. And we've heard about some of the hype about the field, some of the marketing of untested and unproven cell therapies in the clinic that unfortunately have met with some tragic consequences for certain patients and sometimes at great financial cost to them. And upholding public trust in this field is going to take a lot more than avoiding hype. It's going to take rigorous science to produce safe and effective cures. many in this room are keenly aware that the 21st Century Cures Act had several regenerative medicine provisions that applied variously to NIH, NIST, and to FDA. All of those provisions center on a handful of themes. First and foremost, the desire to accelerate cures, truly effective cures through rigorous science and through clear and appropriate regulatory oversight and standards. One of the provisions in that act established the Regenerative Medicine Innovation Project, and it directed NIH to work in coordination with FDA to fund research to advance the field using adult stem cells. It was authorized from 2017 through 2020. And we implemented that project by supporting robust preclinical late-stage IND/IDE-enabling and clinical trials. But it was also important to understand what are the challenges facing the field. And together with FDA, we co-hosted a workshop that identified several universal challenges. Some of the foremost fundamental are shown here. First, the need for regulatory coaching or support that would enable the preparation of robust regulatory applications to help investigators. Second, the difficulty in transitioning from lab grade to truly clinical grade product. Third, our currently limited understanding of the nature and identity of regenerative medicine cells. And fourthly, difficulty in having one study build upon another so that one study informs the next because of limited data standardization and limited data sharing in the field. And so to address this, the FDA, NIH, and NIST have come together and have begun to launch what we're terming the Regenerative Medicine Innovation Catalyst. This is a pilot on the 21st Century Cures to try to accelerate innovation in this field and support investigators. It is intended to provide manufacturing and assistance and regulatory support. It will perform in-depth cell characterization for the products being used in these studies. It will be developing data standards and a common vocabulary that will enable sharing of data and results from these studies so that they can learn from one another. And fourthly, it will be promoting collection and sharing of both data about the product and data from the clinic, and coupling those together and making them available to the community for analysis. And it's our hope that this pilot may be prove valuable and be something that could be expanded to the regenerative medicine field more generally. And I'll wrap up to say that this is not something that we can do alone. There's a strong partnership between the agencies, but it is also going to require a robust engagement with the regenerative medicine community. We think these steps are vital in terms of accelerating and even facilitating the development of safe and effective treatments for our patients. Thank you. Thank you.